Hi there. In this short tutorial, I'm going to demonstrate how to create this very simple effect. It's very simple, but I think it's quite effective. And essentially, this is a cycles volumetric effect. So it's making use of the cycles engine, and you can see how you're getting these light rays coming out of this object in the middle. So to look at the blend file, all you can see is this cube at the moment. But if I go into wireframe view, you can see the object here in the middle, and you can just about make out that there's another object beneath that. So we'll go from the beginning, and we'll first of all just add an icosphere. And I'll put a few more subdivisions on it, not too many, and we'll leave that in the middle there. Go into edit mode, go into face select mode, and deselect everything. Then come down to here and say select random. And that's selecting too many at the moment. But if you look over here, you can reduce the percentage of random faces that are selected. So I'm going to reduce that quite a bit. So somewhere around 9-10%, something like that. Maybe a little more. Okay, so we've got that many faces selected, so I'm going to press X and delete faces. So we've got some holes in it now. Now they're very angular holes right now, so I'm going to do Control 2, which will put a subsurf modifier on it. You could also have just done add subdivision surface. So they're now more rounded holes. And this really is just going to be our base object that will emit the light rays. I need to animate it. So I'm at the beginning of my animation, go to the object properties and press I over rotation. We'll go to the end and I'm going to put 100 for each X, Y and Z and press I again. And if we go back to the beginning and press play, you can see it speeds up and then slows down, but is rotating in all axes. In order to avoid that speeding up and slowing down, if we go to the graph editor, immediately just press key and interpolation mode to linear. Now go back to the 3D view and play again. You can see it's now rotating in all sorts of ways in a very smooth fashion. There's no speeding up or slowing down, it's continuous. Obviously, if you wanted to loop the video, you'd want that at something like 359 degrees instead of 100. So we'll just save that. So that's our shadow, as it were, our shadow mask, if you wish. Next thing we need to do is obviously put a lamp inside it. So Shift A, and we will add a lamp, and it will be a point lamp. Multiple important sample, and probably we want the size fairly small, so we'll try 0.01. The bigger the size, the blurrier those light rays will be, so you want it pretty low. We will need to turn the brightness up, so we'll go for 5000 at the moment. The reason for that is because of the volumetrics we're going to do. It does absorb a lot of light. Now, another thing I did was to add Shift A and add another mesh, and we'll make this a UV sphere, it doesn't really matter too much, and scale it in. The reason for this is because I want some sort of glints at times. So I need a light source that is actually visible. So I'm just having a look here at how big this will be when looking at it through the apertures. So that'll do, and I'll put a material on it, and it'll be an emission material. Fairly bright, we'll put it at 5 with a slight colour to it. Now normally if I had many other things in the field of view, I would put a pass index on this so I could isolate that particular object. But for this scene it's not necessary because there really isn't anything else to worry about. What I do need to do though is go to the object and turn off shadow. I don't want it casting shadows because obviously it's on top of the lamp. If the lamp can't get through this object, then we won't get our light rays. So if we just have a look at that, so you can see there's our object and we've obviously got a light inside it. So now we need to add Shift A to add a mesh, and I'll just make it a cube. We'll go into wireframe and we'll scale that cube up quite a bit. I'll look through the camera view and I'm clicking the edge here to grab the camera and I'll move it down to center my object. Now, one of the things that we need to know for the moment at version 2.70 of Blender is that we cannot render light rays volumetrics in cycles in GPU mode. If you're using GPU mode, it just won't work. We need to be in CPU mode for it to work. So at the moment, we've got no material on that box, so it just shows up as a box. So I'll select it and I'll say new material, and immediately I will go to the node editor. I opened a new window there. So at the moment there's our diffuse material. We don't want that. If you leave a diffuse material on here at all, it will completely remove, as it were, your volumetrics unless you make it at least partially transparent. So I'm going to remove that completely. I'm going to add a mix shader and plug that into volume, and I'm going to leave it at 0.5. I'm now going to add a volume absorption shader and a volume scatter shader. Put the scatter right up there, right up at maximum in terms of the color, and plug that into there. and I'll leave volume absorption where it is for now and plug that into there. So literally, light going into a volume scatter node is bounced off in random directions, so some of it reaches the camera. However, it doesn't cast a shadow. Volume absorption, light literally is absorbed as it passes through a volume that contains that. And you notice we've got these density settings as well. So the computer's going to be a bit slow because it's going to be running in CPU mode, but let's have a look at what that looks like. I'm going to set the preview to 10 and we'll set the border on so we only render what's inside the camera view. So you can see we're getting something. It's pretty good actually. You can see they're fairly blurry as they come towards the camera and then much reduced as they go off into the distance. If we didn't have the absorption node, they would be just as bright, the ones that are going off in the distance, as the ones coming towards us. So we can play around then with the density. If we put the density of the scatter node down to 0.5, we'll also come round and, as I haven't got any water or anything in this scene, I can turn off caustics, which makes it slightly less noisy. And noise is one of the things you will find is inevitable in these sorts of scenes using volumetrics, at the moment at least. It's pretty much inevitable in cycles anyway, but it's particularly bad when you're rendering volumetrics. And when you're rendering volumetrics, looking at light paths, by the way, this is the one that matters. So if you want a higher quality render, you need to increase that, or if there's a lot of complexity to the scene. So I can put that up, for example, and it will take a little bit longer to render. I think I rendered mine at about 3. But obviously give us a nicer render. I'm just going to go to my point lamp now, I think, and give that a more noticeable color. What I'm also going to do now is I'm going to set my samples to 25 and I'll do a proper render, because what I think I'm ready to do now is to do some post-processing, which is the only thing left really. Okay, that's a 25 sample render. I think one of the things I'm going to do is reduce the brightness of that lamp a little. We'll go for 3000. And what I'm also going to do is add a little clamping. So I'll clamp indirect lighting a small amount and we'll render that again. Okay, and you can see that's quite a bit better. And you can play around with clamping settings and so on. Obviously that's only 25 samples, so it's still very noisy, but it's starting to give you the idea. So we're going to do some compositing on it now, or post-processing. So we'll click on this to go to the scene settings and click use nodes. So there's our render layer just going straight out to this area. So the first thing I'm going to do is just try to smooth it out a little bit, because one of the problems while we're using CPU render mode is that you really, unless you've got an awful lot of time or an incredibly powerful CPU, you don't want render times that take too long. This took about a minute and 15 seconds, which is fine for a still image. You could leave it running for hours. But if you want to run an animation, which is what I did previously, then obviously a minute is quite a long time. If you're willing to take the days it's going to take to render any significant number of frames, then that's fine. But certainly if like me, you're on a schedule, you've only got a day or two to sort things out, then you need to cheat a little bit, really, if you want to call it that. And this works for many things. So the first thing we're going to do is add a filter, which is going to be a blur filter. We'll drop that into there. Change it to fast Gaussian, put it on relative. Relative just means it, because the X and the Y are not the same size, it will be a percentage of them rather than an absolute value. It's up to you, I typically use relative. So if we put 1% and 1%, you can see that's much too much, unless that's an effect you're going for. Perhaps 0.2 and 0.2. So if I press M with that blur node selected, that will mute it as it were, or remove it from the effect. And you can see there's a very slight difference. If I zoom in a little bit, that's without it and that's with it. So it's just smoothed it slightly without really blurring the image too much. So that's improved it a little bit. The next thing we want to do is add a little bit of glare. So I'll add another node, it's another filter, and it's a glare filter. We'll drop that into there. And what I preferred to use was the ghosts, which is the sort of effect you get from lenses when there's a bright light shining on them. So it depends on exactly how bright your scene is, but obviously that's quite a bit. We can increase the threshold to cut that back a little bit. We can change the mix as well. Mine was quite subtle on the first video I did. There you can start to see it there. You can increase the iterations, possibly a bit too much there. And I'll drop the mix back a bit more as well and increase the threshold a bit more. And maybe increase the color modulation. So you can see it's like it's glaring off a lens because of the bright ball I put in the middle there shining through here. And if we were to go to a different part of the scene, we would lose that little glare when the ball is hidden by one of these darker areas. So really, that's all there is to this effect. I hope you enjoyed that. This is the second of two tutorials I've done today. and I'll hopefully publish them both this week. Thanks a lot, and I'll see you in the next tutorial.